created. Them make no good, them gyal a walk naked. Them fans inna the street frustrated.
Real dead is life.
I'm the real Nicodemus.
Nexus. I want to deal it. A Nexus. Enough focus. Yo. In your bad mind, you know the top Nexus sound in your arm. Oh, Thunderball, oh, some soul. You know the top Nexus sound in your arm. Oh, Thunderball.
Yeah, man, this is Sheldon representing the big bad sound Nexus. Jamaica, the computer cyber staff, the larger status.
In soon we're running out of time. Soon we're running out of time. Soon we're running out of time. All across the world, something strange is happening. Soon we get defeated by Nexus sound system.
Good night, good night, good
no
night.
One can test
good night,
the champion.
Good night, good night, good night. So good to be here again tonight. Those of you who are here the first time, this fellow was telling you why I'm still here. Tonight I'm going to tell you why I came here. It's all a story, you know? It's all a story of life, the journey. People you meet, the things you do, and all those other things. But before I move further ado, let us bring in the big man in the real big man.
Milton to
big artist Ali. Yeah man, big artist Ali. Come in a church one Sunday a year, man, me have to congratulate him, you know? And we just buck up again. And we just buck up again and here we are again. Doing what we're doing together. So without God, nothing is possible. So Ali. Danny Browning, me tell you if you link me up on Facebook for this program. Listen to this youth of Danny Browning. He want a good producer.
I said, Lord.
DP, you're supposed to know him too, right? You say he won the Gospel Festival here in Portland.
Of you, Lord, as I lift my voice, yeah.
Want to bring up all the Styles family tonight. You see? I get a chance to drive the bus tonight, but I have to remember who did put the bus on the road, you know? We have a slight little mic problem, but that won't stop the thing. Still, I do what we are doing, you keep on enjoying what you're enjoying,
yeah?
Have a lot of people sang tonight, a whole lot of people. Whole heap of people to thank tonight for me to be here. First of all, as I said, the Styles family, and of course the big man Louis Lecky for inviting me to be here tonight. Yes, I want to thank all the people on the George Cohen. Yeah, the Lisa Jai, Mrs. Hutche, Mrs. Thompson, Mrs. Becky, Phyllis, Mr. Samson, Miss Richards, everybody, and of course the Queen and Empress. Well tight, Christine. Love is love.
Was distrusted. So many things lied for us to be in bondage. So many things lied. So many things. But I'm protected by your blood that washed my sins.
Going to use the first part of the show really to just take a little care of since I've been here business, you know? Yeah, Ali again.
Mama cry for the youths them who are stray from the Most High. Weeping mother who are crying for your daughter. Almighty Father, we need love not slaughter. Cause in the presence of the Lord there is fullness of joy. Mama cry woe, have mercy on me. Mama cry woe,
yeah. Hope's a little better there over there in Radio Land. And then all the friends on Facebook, eh? Yeah. Father Gooden, Pitchfield, Altitude Massive, O'Shane, all the people in Posse Garden, Dr. J, Shireen, Carrie Ann, Miss Match, Sigrid, Clyde, yeah man, Brandon. Of course, me have a link up online of a big virgin, Dio, and Victor, Taylor. You the really have a thing. Smith family, Jerry Smith, all the Draper's crew. Yeah. It's a Bramwell from ACIJ. Yeah. Yeah, man. But at the end of the day, you know, there's one man I wish was here tonight.
Yeah.
Time you take for granted the time when you spend with friends. Now them gone.
I want them gone.
Yes, the streets are running deep. When I ask who you make me love. When you tell me some grand, you tell me some smart. So break my heart, see your
bones. When I came to Portland, the first place I really hung out was Prospect. One of the first man I met in Prospect was General Speedy, you know? Yeah, man. Good youth. When I was floundering and needed an anchor, needed a harbor. Tough times. Yeah, Speedy. So you're not there tonight, my virgin, but it's about love and respect, you know? And at the end of the day, it's not how you live, it's how you're remembered, and how you are remembered has a lot to do with how you live, you know? And a lot of people really missing out being here tonight, my brother. But to all the Prospect crew, Tread, Dentist, Pata, Tabele, all the other people up there. Yeah. Yeah.
Life is so real, yeah. As a little youth used to hang up on the corner. Me and the one of my friend and we have on some. I don't know if we never grew up with no father. Still we have to try the best to make it cross the border.
It's not about, the fallen soldier. It's about the standing soldier.
Yeah, yeah.
DeMarco.
Love.
Get to you.
Respect.
Them know how we reach the way. Them only while we listen when them teach me.
Respect that, Jacko. Respect again, my brother.
Get to you, stuff and live nowhere.
Them while we fall, but that now I'm not a
Hey, Louis Lecky, a German bass tonight. I have some surprises for you, now. You come see, you know, Louis. I have some surprises for you tonight, you know. Yeah, man, you don't know, you know, Louis. German bass tonight, you know. Yeah, I have the drum and me have the bass, you know. The way I do it tonight, you're going to listen, you know. You see, the last time I came here, you met, let me tell you who you met. You met Mikey Bell, Miss Sita Pitney. You met Jamaics, the selector. And you met Mikey Bell, the guy in the streets. But tonight, you're going to meet Mikey Rebel, the musician, and Michael Anthony Bell, the writer and the artist. Yeah, man. The writer, the artist, and the author. Yeah, man. It's all about the integration, my brother. It's all about doing what we have to do and do it the best way we can, you know? The first question I need to answer tonight is why I came to Portland in the first place. A lot of people have it to say what them have it to say, and them have to say what them have to say, but I'm just chilling at the Gideon, you know, my brother. Just chilling at the Gideon. Came here for one reason and one reason only. And that was to edit my book. Yeah. The name of the book, The Hands of Time. I'm going to sound like Jotex tonight because I got one. Now it's two reasons why the book has that name. It's apostrophe. It's not H-A-N-D-S. It's apostrophe. A-N-D-S. Of time. The Hands of Time. And the reason why I gave it that title, two reasons. One, if I put the H-A-N-D-S, that would mean an ergonomic thing, time and motion, Skinnerian kind of thing. But I wasn't looking at time as it passes. I was looking at the implication of time. Because the subtitle of the book is Cause, Effect, Conscience, and Consequences. So I was looking how these elements develop over time. We know time is a subjective thing, although it's a quantity out there, because a lot of time people say time move fast or it moves slow, and time is just moving the way it's moving. The next reason is that in an integrated market, as a marketeer, I need to position myself so that I can be differentiated. If you go on the net and you put in the H-A-N-D-S of times, our time, I'm sure you're going to get about a million hits. But if you put in apostrophe A-N-D-S, just like how styles do them thing, S-T-Y-L-Z, if you put that in on the radio, on the internet, you only get one hit. But if it was S-T-Y-L-E-S, it would have been many. So it was that in mind. The third thing is why I wrote the book in the first place. Well, first, from I was back in university, I met upon this guy. I was in my teens then, and he was a younger guy than me. And he was the one who was running the whole place. I mean, running the place. And this is a guy with a carry gun come to me and tell me, put down gun and this and that and that. And I tell him, sir, we're not really not them thing there. And he threatened me enough time. And I tell him, sir, boy, better kill me if you kill me now. But me just not going to deal with them thing there. The long and short of it is 4 years after knowing this guy came to me one day and said to me, you know, says 4 years, me I watch you for kill you now. If you know who me I talk about, if you read the book and understand the character, you don't understand. So I'd have been, must have been frightened. Because this is a guy every week, him show me a different gun. I'm used to have a way him come to me and say, me try it out last night, you know. And in time, him said that made race. Because I know, so that is one more man gone down. Anyway, him tell me, say, 4 years, me watch him for kill me. But I realize, he's a youth, you know. So I said, why you want to kill me? Why, because you give me a gun and I'm going to put them down? He said, no. I don't take orders, and I supposed to take orders. And him relate to him, relate to, and him tell him that anybody who goes to university and down to earth and deal with people and thing is communist. And him swear to kill every communist. But him realize, I only deal with my books and my music and my things, so nobody can touch me. So when I realize, I'm on his side. I said to him, so tell me why. Why you want to kill communists? And he told me his life story. And at the time, I said, I'm going to write the book, but I get involved in the music thing, and family come along, and one thing lead to another. And somehow I feel like the story wasn't any more relevant, so I put it down. And of course, I met in an accident, went through a windscreen, lose my memory, things get this and that and that, and my daughter was me, daughter no more, or me alone, I just became a nomad, went back into the ghetto, decided to go for a few days, it turned up to be exactly a year, and during the time I was there, a place smaller than Boundbrook, over 20 people dead. And I realized that the story is just as relevant today as it was, and even more relevant today than it was then. So, I start writing, finish the book, and decided I'm going to come to Portland and edit the book. And that's why I'm here. You have an idea about the book? Okay. Now, before I really touch that, there is one little more thing that I'd like to deal with. There's the things you do for yourself, you keep it with you, but things you do for others, you leave it behind. And this station is ideally placed not only to let us inside here know what's going on outside, but more importantly, to let people outside know what's going on in here. And in terms of our artistry and so on, we have artists all over the place that are doing things. So I see it as my duty and my duty to go out there and do what I can for them. You know, just straight up like that. No big deal, no question, nothing behind it. So I want to feature these guys call themselves Nyla Records. Their own breastwork side. People like Aya Pure and David and Daniel and rest of the guys them around there. Don't really know them like that, but I've heard what they are doing and they have some interesting music concept. Look more lyrics, I've got to go on and thing and look at thing and thing, but you hear this now?
Yes, ma'am.
This rhythm is already me produced from long time in university, name Every Little Nothing. Of our tune right, name Every Little Nothing.
Yes, ma'am.
internationally again. I'm here to say I am pure, representing the next of sound. I'm here to say Jamaica. And I say, hey, all that I need is that
I want to big up all the Norwich crew. Paulette and all the other people I'm up in Norwich, yeah? Yeah, man. Cox and Marlene and, of course, I want to big up the councillor himself and the members of parliament for both. Mr. Vaz and Dr. Bloomfield. Yeah, man. Both of them. Big them up. Respect you. I love where I deal with tonight, you know. Not only tonight, but all the time. Love. Love, my brother. This is from me young. I realize there's three things I can't afford. Badness, drugs, and HIV. Three very expensive things. Very, very expensive. So, three things me try avoid anyway me can. So, make the music do the talking. Nyla Records again.
Yes, man.
I pure.
I'm here naturally again. I to the pure, you know. Love music. Hey, summertime and be having a party. Roll out me and my shawty.
Yes, I pure. Yeah. Go forth and sin no more.
Time all the girls come join me in your sexy bikini. A summertime.
Well, big up Mrs. Philpott and Mr. Philpott, you know, all the people up on the ends and the hills, you know, people like Miss Claudia Woolery, and of course Miss Woolery, and of course Miss Helen Green and Jamie and all the people on span the ends and the ends and the ends and down the road, Mr. Sigree and Marissa and Peaches and Joe and Clive and Nyla Records again. We'll touch one more with Nyla and then we move on, you know? I'm up in a Brexworks and these guys looking for the links and the contacts. I'm gonna look for the links and contacts. If you don't have anybody out there who can deal with it and work with them, because we want to bring some money into the place, you know. Because let me tell you, Portland, if we don't highlight what we have, highlight the good things of we, then we don't really make the money, you know, because we always have to be highlighting people's things. So, nothing wrong, you know, we don't disrespect people's things. Don't get me wrong, you know. But we have to look out for ourselves first. Them say, pastor always baptized in Pitney first, or something, or Christian, or whichever. Don't. That's all for them.
And the little girl, look how you miss up her education. She want, and that's how she says, so far you take a sit and die. When her mama dress up her right to wait, and the nanny want the wickedness a spy. The link to
your touch, we'll touch one more.
Realize it.
No, you've just
Nyla Records.
It.
Yeah, man.
Keep it. Live it.
I am pure. I have to smoke before my gummy bear.
Yeah.
I'm rising at the man in me have a hole of me.
All right.
My brain is bouncing on the clouds.
Now that you have been holding it.
Yo.
Actually see yourself in it.
Yeah, yeah. Love where I deal with, my brother.
I said actually feel yourself in it.
Love where I deal with. Every step of
meditate
the way.
Meditate it.
Every step of the way.
Now you have just put your thought in action. And all you have to do is move in the motion. And the universe will take care of the rest. Meditation is like that part of you. When it says, if you have as much faith within oneself, one can move mountain. Same way, if you have much faith in one belief, one can manifest this belief.
Yeah. Well, like I said, I introduced you to a lot of people about myself. Well, I'm going to introduce you now. Louis, hear this now. Yeah, Lou, me your brethren from time, don't. Long time. You see, this book, Louis, are the second phase of my memory recovery process. The first stage, you know, Louis, that was the music collection. Because when I came out of hospital, believe me, Louis, when I turned on my computer, tears came to my eyes, man. There's a difference between forgetting something and not remembering something than when you know something and you know that you don't know it. So I see you then, Louis, before that time. I know, see, if I saw you before the accident, first time I see you, I go, no, see, I know you, know, but I not going to know you. You understand the point, man? So, and I have to go through the whole process. In my brethren, Brahma, Mr. Brahma, me and him is at African Caribbean Institute of Jamaica, and he's over here now, big up the Draper's crew, Draper's crew, Jerry Smith and all them, man. Mama, of course, Mama, Empress Rosie, yes, respect and love. And the big man, Skipper Dan. Yo, all right, so I shook it up tonight, yeah. Tasha, the whole lot, all of my group on Facebook, Ripton, Mr. Blackford, me like your book, Top Ranking, push it, make it happen. Yeah, man. So, it's all of that, Louis. So, at this time now, I want to introduce you guys to Mikey Rebel, the musician.
Hearing the music of a group called Black Sapphire and I, and they're normally to be found on campus at University of the West Indies, and I want them to introduce themselves.
Mikey Bell, but most people call me Mikey Rebel, and I'm the bass player.
Yeah, me and the RX-21 drum machine, Louis. Never have no drum at them time, eh?
I'm going back to that girl. I'm fixing all my life. I'm going to cut her.
I want to tell all the people I'm up in St. Mary. Sheldon, Big Stone. Sheldon, are you me a feature tonight, my youth? Yeah, man, me a play a couple of your tunes because it's enough for a tune I'm a play tonight, ladies and gentlemen. I never played them tunes anyway yet before tonight. But the whole thing come together, the book. And as, you know, like a good book, you don't really understand it until it finish. I want this show to be a good show. You understand it all when it finish. So Sheldon, all the man named Sheldon Campbell, one of the nicest artists me ever worked with. Very good writer, very good singer, and very good person. So hear me, listen to this. This is back in the university days when this is the music I was into, what I was playing while this guy was coming to me with this gun thing and this dead thing and this thing. Listen.
But what they're scared of if they have talent?
No, well, it's not just talent alone. What we are doing is that we are trying something that has never been done before, you know? And our idea is to be holistic and eclectic, to do something, to tread a new path, so to speak. Because hadn't Bob and those people done that, they wouldn't have made an impression on the footprint of time.
Got a young Mikey Bell in a university, I try to sound like him intelligent. But me not fool nobody.
She was really my cup of tea. So many men wrote about her. Many men were a cup of tea. She took her head in the field from she died, one. She said, oh, I'm not feeling like the way you go. I'll take you across the seas. I'll make you ride on your bended knees. Welcome to my house of sin. I'd like you to live in. Ain't nobody, baby, gonna mess with my life. What? To the rhythm, to the beat, to the beat, to the beat, one.
of gold. University youth. University youth are trying to find themselves, you know. Peace is smarter than Socrates and all those things, you know. St. Margaret's Bay SBA, Seventh-day Adventist, was out there on Saturday, you know. Really nice experience, really, really nice. Mrs. Newman, Sir Newman, respect Mr. Hoffman, Mr. Larson, and a little second farmer in Titchfield is in the service. And I can tell you, Sir Titchfield, when I come second 3 years straight in, brother, but no worry, that's no coincidence, and no worry. The arts favor you in the life the next time. But no worry, this is a youth. I can't remember my name. But you know, good in religious studies, because the youth I'm knowing Bible for a little second farmer. There's love and respect for that. Anyways, that being what it may, I don't want to introduce you to the book, The Hands of Time. And what happened is that most of what I recover since my accident, I kind of know it through music, because really the music used to bring back memory. I went to neurologist and spent about thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars, and then the DM tell me, same, can't really help me. That was it. But I found out that whenever I play the music and think, coming way back, you know, from way back in the time, little boy in high school, Michigan and Smiley, start out in the electronics thing from tube days where I use ECC 83 and KT 88, then up to transistors, then up to integrated circuit, then up to microprocessors and computers. So I was always like there, and I was really a computer whiz, man. I tell them, could I just look on a computer and fix it? Structured query language, Excel, them thing that, they, you know, all software come down here with American tax thing and convert it and all of that. But my virgin, after the accident, it's like everything changed. Everything. And I'm still trying to regain what I had, you know? And this book is a part of the process. So I found out in writing the book, because maybe it's not that I write the book, you know, maybe it's the book write me. Because a lot of things that came out, I didn't even remember them, but in writing it came out. So what I'm going to do at this stage is that I'm going to read a few excerpts from the book, The Hands of Time. And I'm going to, each chapter start with a song, a music. And what I found out is that a lot of the headings for the chapters, I can't get them out of music. They are lines in music or something, or the title of a song or something. I haven't been able to complete that process yet in terms of the soundscape, but I can read some excerpts and play the music that were selected. Dio, respect me out. Yeah, here we go.
I was a victim of the hands of time. Chapter 1. If 6 was 9, the end of the beginning. I was numbed and neutered. I was a victim of the hands of time. I was constrained, castrated, castigated and cast off. I was nullified, negated, and neutralized. I was nothing. I was shell-shocked, speechless, surprised, stupefied, stunned, and bowled over as I stared unbelievingly at the morning's newspaper's headline. I was like disorientated, dazed, confounded, baffled, fuddled, and flummoxed. I was all at sea. I was thoroughly lost as I stared at the unbelievable words. I was knocked off balance by this illogical, irrational, unpredicted, and unexpected blow. My head was empty and my brain was frozen inside. Eyes wide open, but I was going blind. I searched my being and no happiness, no joy I could find. I choked on the cruel contradictions and the harsh reality of life. I was dizzy with fright. My tears welled up as my sorrows climbed. My emotions, so twisted, so entangled, and so entwined. My heart, my soul, and my mind were battered and bruised by the hands of time,
She was crippled for life, but she couldn't speak a sound, and she wished and prayed she could stop living, so she decided to die. She drew a wheelchair to the edge of the shore.
This news, this event, this state of affairs now confronting me was something I thought that was totally improbable. It was an occurrence in my sad, disappointing, and chaotic life that I thought was totally impossible. I was prepared for the worst. I was impermeable, prepared for anything that life threw at me, but totally unprepared for this. My mind, my body, my whole existence found it impossible to grasp, believe, or accept. I stared at the newspaper again. My mind freaked and zoomed out as my eyes zoomed in. I zoomed in and my thoughts entered the twilight zone. I was Casper in the ghost world. I wanted to escape through Einstein's door of relativity and enter his world where time is just an illusion, just the fourth dimension. I wanted more than GPS. I wanted to be in a world, in an existence where the past, the present and the future were all happening at once. I would then shift around and change things to suit my wishes and desires. I wanted my yesterday to be my today and my today to be my tomorrow. I wanted to rewind time, to go back to before the Big Bang. I desperately wanted to enter this world and I had the key, but I could not find the door. Eventually, I came to my senses and the realization that all this denial stuff was just an exercise in futility. I had to accept the destiny waiting for me. I had to accept the reality that was. There was no way out and no way around the fate that lies ahead. I had to be a man, keep my chin up, fight the bullet, sit up and swallow my medicine. In the long run, vacillation was worse than not accepting. So, I bit the bullet, shook myself off, sit up and strengthened my resolve. But I still could not swallow my medicine. When you have been fooled and failed by all other possibilities, when there is no love or sympathy, the only thing left is reality. Eventually, I turned my attention to the newspaper and scanned the headline again. I read cautiously and silently, slowly digesting while the cold, taunting, and uncaring words screamed at me mockingly.
They were splattered or something shot dead.
The headline shouted triumphantly at my full attention. I nibbled down to the byline,
the Don known as the Survivor killed execution style.
I paused, hesitated, and halted briefly. For a moment, waiting for the adrenaline of reality to kick in further and to gain the strength to carry on with the ordeal of reading the rest of this story. I then latched on, choking on, and dissecting every word.
Devon Splatter Thompson, the reputed Don of Dons, crime lord, and drug kingpin, was found shot to death last night. He was executed in a professional manner in his lavish, gated, and upscale mansion in the exclusive and well-guarded Cherry Gardens community. He had just beaten an extradition request and was slated to be the star witness at the Commission of Inquiry on Organized Crime next week. The processing of his extradition request was unusual and again had caused strained relations between Kingston and Washington, even though both sides had gone to great lengths to deny it. 2 weeks ago, he had used an admissibility of evidence and statute of limitation clause to unexpectedly and unprecedentedly beaten an extradition request to the United States of America. His legal team of high-powered lawyers is beating his chest in victory, but legal luminaries closely following the proceedings said it was not just a case of Thompson beating the extradition trap. The U.S. Justice Department suddenly lost interest in the extradition request. The question is, what sort of pressure was used to bring about such an unexpected and unprecedented development? Persons who were able to examine the documents used for filing said that the paperwork was in order and it did not have any flaws or procedural errors, and there are no lapses or omissions. All the accompanying affidavits and other supporting documents were presented in what seems like a watertight case. These facts, if they are correct, cast a doubt on the legal follow-up argument and lend more to the argument that there are other factors involved. The Justice Department had never gone this far in an extradition matter and then retreated. There were no signs of forced entry in the Thompson's house. A cabinet, which was secured using a state-of-the-art electronic encryption system and which houses the hardware and other vital components of Thompson's advanced security system, was breached. The recording of the time of his death is missing. The duplicate that was automatically uploaded and stored on a secured internet server overseas and served as a backup was mysteriously hacked and scrubbed, leaving cybersecurity experts scratching their heads in disbelief. The complete scope of the staging of the operation and subsequent cleanup suggests that a high-level team was involved in coordinating the move. There are speculations as to how the country's economy will function. There are also questions as to how Thompson's wide-ranging business interests will fare. There are concerns about the importation of and distribution of some of the nation's most essential goods and commodities. These are necessary for the smooth running of many of the nation's activities for which Thompson's companies have a virtual monopoly. These undertakings were profitable, but they were just a front for his more successful and profitable crime business. It is also suggested that his private bank is holding marks for many top-level businessmen who had to turn to him for financial support in a tight money market. Many had used his bank to get liquidity through private placement. There are no leads or suspects for his murder this time.
When I reached the end of the report, I sat back and slowly drank it in like it was a hot, scalding beverage. It was a poison to my soul. I had spoken with Splatter just 2 weeks ago. I slowly opened my eyes and glanced at the now cold Cannot Drink Again coffee as my stomach churned. For someone who had done so much, survived the certain death so many times and lived to smile about it, to have come to such an inauspicious, dramatic, unexpected and farcical end was somewhat comical and paradoxical. It was a massive deflation and a catastrophic anticlimax. I gripped the handle of my past, focused across the ears of my desires, and chambered rounds of recollection. I released the safety of apprehension, precaution, and self-delusion. I squeezed the trigger of my willpower. The hammer of command struck the cap of determination and exploded the shell of self and historical analysis. I felt the recoil of my life that had passed, and I smelled the acrid smoke of despair as I flashed back. The bullet of my mind cascaded down the tunnel of my life, down the barrel of time, to the carbine, to the point, the plume, and to the flashpoint of an office. I felt the jolt, the pressure, the impact, and the blood and pain of regret, disappointment, distress, sorrow, and grief as I surgically opened the wound where Devon Thompson's path and mind first crossed many years ago, and our lives and our existence became irreversibly, irrevocably, and inextricably interwoven forever, 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 forever.
Yeah. That was the first, basically an excerpt from the first chapter of the book. This book basically covers what went and what is to come. So this part of the book really was looking at Wednesday, September the 12th, 2018. That is when this report was done. The book actually goes up to 2020. Starts in 1975 and goes back. So I'll do a little thing now for chapter two. For the first couple of chapters, I'll give you a framework as to how the book set up. But for the rest of the chapters going down, I'll just more or less just play the soundscape. All right?
Chapter 2, Ambush in the Night.
Dr. Gartner on.
A barrage of shots rang out, shattering the still of the night. The sudden uproar sent the usually boisterous and barking dogs scattering from the din and confusion. Gunshots were not strange in this neighborhood, but the shattering of Devon's bedroom window was. Devon was off the bed in a flash and crouched low. He was below the window ledge and then below the before the shattered glass hit the floor. Devon was only 10 years old then. He was the youngest of his family, but he was no neophyte or coward. This instinctive maneuver was almost reflex action. He had been in situations before. He had been in tussles and full-blown fights. He was always on the alert. His environment had schooled him daily in the art of fighting, warfare, survival, and the skills of evasive and aggressive action. His active and alert mind, keen sense of observation and assimilation had set the stage for that response. He was no bully, but he never backed away from a challenge, no matter the odds. Another rapid and brutal burst erupted, and some of the rounds flew through the broken window as he hit the floor and sent him down even further. He ended up flat out on the floor. Devon heard his scream in her bedroom. At that moment, his brother Colin rushed into his bedroom. Devon glanced up just in time to see Colin being flung back in the direction from whence he came. He slammed with brutal force against the wall. Colin's hands went slowly and animatedly to his neck. His glazed, vacuous eyes stared in confusion into the cold darkness through the broken window from whence the hurt came. Almost immediately, his hands turned crimson red. These places of abode are the political, social, and mental garrisons, the domiciles, dugouts, ditches, and domains of the disparaged, the disgraced, the disbelieved, the doubted, the distrusted, the demeaned, the discarded, the disaster-prone, the disheartened, and the doomed. These are the denizens of darkness, decay, decomposition, dismay, disputes, division, disorder, disloyalty, detachment, devastation, demolition, damage, disillusions, duplicity, dichotomy, disbeliefs, and the card and dice. These are the bickering, bantering, bastions, bunkers, barrows and barges of brutality, betrayal, barricades, blockades, bars, bolts, zinc roofs, and barbed wire fences. These are the barbarians, barnyards of bandits, the bed and bosom of the berated, the belittled, the beguiled, and the bedeviled. These are the gates of hell and Hades, the gibberish gutos of wolves and gossip, and the forked tongues, fiefdom, and fortress of the forfeited, the forlorn, the fragmented, the forsaken, the frustrated, and the forgotten. These are dens and dirges of the desperados, the damned, the denied, the beclaimed, the dishonored, the denigrated, the depressed, the discouraged, the disinherited, the disavowed, the disenfranchised, the displaced, the deleted, and the desolated. These are they who are immersed and immured in the ingresses and institutions of the imbeciles, who are imbued, instilled, infused, and impregnated with injudicious, indiscreet, insidious, and insatiable iniquities, infidelities, indiscretions, inconstancies, incautiousness, impetuousness, irresponsibility, idiosyncrasies, and imprudence. These are the prisons, pens, pokies, and penitentiaries of permanent occupation that are plagued with poltergeists, phantoms, perennial problems, and plurality of purpose. These are the enclaves and the enclosures of exclusion, and the places of partition, partage, and permanent rendition. These are the communities, confines, cages, and communes of cliques and clandestine cooperation. These are the slimy pits for those who are the footstools of humanity. These are the places where the good, the bad, and the indifferent cohabitate in courts of combats and culpability. The places where the good people and the hypocrite are forced to live in forged and forced embraces and alliances. This is the mingling, mixing, and collision of the good people who cannot do bad and the bad people who cannot do good. All are cooking. All are stewing in the searing, scalding, curdling cauldron of catastrophe. All are compressed and lined up side by side in the rat race for life. The rat race for survival. In the end, this war is not about the fight for profit, wealth, and power. On a global scale and on a local scale, this war, this senseless killing of one another, transcends flesh and blood and the things we see before us. It is bigger than the fight for victory at the ballot box, the hunger for power, and the control of the hearts and minds of men. It is a war for the right to spill the blood of the young, the weak, the innocent, and the righteous. Ultimately, this war is about spiritual wickedness in high and low places.
So policeman, go slap your face, you know, go talk.
Despite the nutritional hardship that Miss Dice had faced, she was still a strong, big woman. With superhuman effort, she heaved up Colin against her tired, weary shoulder. He was conscious but groggy. With help from Alan and Devon, they headed down Payne Avenue. With wire in tow, looking menacing, his hand on his waist, the imploded mob parted and gave the broken, destroyed family, passage to exile. In the melee, Colin had to leave his dogs behind to fend for themselves in the midst of wicked, uncaring, and indifferent persons who preyed on the weak and the defenseless. His best friend had to remain in the midst of those self-absorbed persons who gained pleasure, legitimacy, and ascendancy from the suffering of others. On their way to exile, the cooking cylinder in their burning house exploded and sent the skittish crowd scampering, first out of fright and then out of concern for their own personal safety. Most of the mob used the explosion as a pretense and escaped the presence of the family. Taxi drivers were scared of this part of town at night. Only a few traveled this way at that hour, and even fewer would stop. After a long wait, they got Colin to hospital in time to save his life. No fire trucks came that night. There was no police investigation that night, and there was no processing of the crime scene. The family did not have a phone for themselves, and no one dared make that call to summon the fire truck or police. As far as the establishment was concerned, these were just warring factions of selfish, misled, misguided, illiterate, and wicked people killing each other. True. But who misled them? Those with their hands on the lever pretend as if they were not the one who created the situation, laid out the groundwork, and mapped the topography for these atrocities. They sniff in aloof purity as if they are not the one who created the problems by their various blind, selfish, and self-centered maneuvers. They washed their hands and turned the dam over to Caiaphas.
We have Mikey with his book and giving the program a different flavor tonight. And you know, say, yeah, only for the Thursday night groove you hear everything. You know what I'm saying?